So it's an introduction to the main workflows on targeted proteomics. But before going into the details, I would also like to know your experience on proteomics, targeted proteomics, whether how many of you, for example, have previously worked on proteomics? Okay, good. And how many of you have experience on targeted proteomics, SRM, for instance? And how many of these people do their own experiments and their own data analysis? Okay, so let's move step forward also now in SWAP, or data independent protocols. So how many of you have experience on this? Okay, one.
Hands up.
What? Hands up?
Yeah. Hands up.
Okay. One, two, three. Okay. So in this course, as Rudy already mentioned before, so we will mainly focus on SRM workflows and data independent MS2 acquisition workflows and data analysis. And we'll review this from the theoretical point of view and also from the practical point of view. So now I will introduce several other types also of targeted approaches and putting special mention on SRM and so on, right? And also before starting, I would like to know maybe whether you could give me some inputs on this question. So what do you think is targeted proteomics? Okay, maybe, I don't know, volunteer. It's there.
Yeah, for me, targeted proteomics is to search for non-protein.
Okay, so, non-protein.
Non-protein, yeah.
Okay.
It's the main point. Try to quantify these in several conditions.
Okay, so known proteins, so a set of known proteins, and quantify them in several conditions. Okay, there, maybe you. Okay. Okay. Any other input on this? Okay, so we had set of proteins, several conditions, and quantitative data sets, right? And then, so let's see also, this is a special issue that Rudy already showed in his talk, and let's see how this they define targeted proteomics here and which concepts are highlighted, right? And what I like is that actually you, right, so you agree with also with this, that is a set of targeted proteomics, targeted proteins of interest. So this is not everything, but actually you have a set of proteins that you want to measure, you have hypotheses, so it's developing assays for measuring, identifying, and quantifying these proteins. And this has to be sent with high sensitivity and quantitative accuracy and reproducibility, right? So here there is also the concept of not only identifying these proteins, but quantifying these proteins. In the same issue, there is another paper, right? And there, Picotti and Rudy himself, so defines these targeted methods as by delivering precise reproducible quantification of proteins of interest, right? Again, not only identification, but quantitation, and not for everything, but just for a subset of proteins that you want to measure. So given this, now we will move forward the particularities or the details on the workflow, so how we operate the mass spectrometers to actually acquire and analyze this type of targeted data sets. And for doing this, I would like first to go to or review the screening or discovery proteomics workflows and how the mass spectrometers are operated in this mode. So as you know, so we have a chromatographic column, and from this column in screening proteomics, there are a lot of analytes, peptides, thousands of peptides that are eluting. This we have a mass analyzer, and that is operating in a screening mode. So we can have an MS1, spectrum where we record the mass and intensity, so we have a peak for every single species or molecule that is eluting from the column at a given moment. Okay, so this is not the only information that we have, but actually we don't only want to have mass information of these molecules, but also the sequence of these peptides. And as you know, so we can do this by tandem mass spectrometry by combining one analyzer and a second analyzer. So we first screen. Once we know what is eluting at this moment from the column, we select, for instance, the most intense, right, the red. So we select. So we now operate this first mass analyzer as a filter. So we only select this, we fragment, and we operate the second mass analyzer as a screening mode so that we have all the fragments recorded. From this information, we can, of course, deduce with search engines or by manual annotation the identification or the properties or the sequence of this peptide. Okay, and then what we can do actually is not only select the most intense, but the second most intense, so the green, and so filter this, obtain the MS2 spectra, deduce the sequence, and do the same for the third, and so on and so forth. So at the end, what we have in this discovery or shotgun or screening proteomics mode is that we have an MS1 followed by, in this case, three MS2. This would be the top N, in which we have so an MS2 for the most intense, an MS2 for the second most intense, and a third MS2 for the third most intense. This is the top three. And actually, then we would start again with another MS1. So checking what is eluting from the column so that we can trigger MS2 information. This is what we would call a cycle, and this is the time axis. So here we could again select the most intense one and so on and so forth. But actually, this would not be very advisable, as for example, in this case, the most intense one is exactly the same as we would have fragmented here. So we would have we would be acquiring redundant information. And this is why normally these discovery proteomics have this dynamic exclusion mode, where we say, well, check or take the most intense one unless it has been already fragmented previously. So how does a shotgun or discovery workflow looks like? So it looks like something like this. So we have an MS1 followed by N MS2, another MS1 followed by N MS2, and so on and so forth. Each of these clusters is a cycle, and then there is a succession of these cycles, right? And currently applying this type of proteomics workflows, what we can identify is, for instance, in protein labs, in QTOF instruments or Orbitrap instruments, around 2,000 proteins, both in yeast not fractionation or human not fractionation. This can go from 2,000, 3,000, also depending on the chromatographic setup. And with fractionation, there has been achieved the identification and quantitation of 4,000 proteins, which is two-thirds of the open reading frames in yeast, and around 10,000 proteins in human. And although now with these big human projects, right, that have been collecting a lot of data from different tissues and different sources, the number of identification of proteins that have been identified has been enlarged, right? But this not in a single sample, but in a collection of samples would be. Okay. The problem of this, let's check the. So I tried to reduce the temperature, but I'm not sure it will. Okay, well, at least it seems so, right? So in this type of proteomic approaches, what happens is that we cannot, as also Rudy explained in his keynote, is that we cannot identify the whole proteome. So all the there are too many peptides eluting from the column, and we can only target specific ones for identification. Therefore, when we have one run, so we can identify a subset of the proteome, and when we have a second run, so we identify another subset, mostly overlapping, but there is a part which is not overlapping. This is a problem when this number of runs is increasing, because actually, for example, in three runs, the number of proteins that we identify in all of the three runs, so that this would be proteins that we actually then afterwards we can compare between these three runs, is much less than the number of identifications, which would be the union of these three subsets, right? And then if, as we were mentioning in the definition of targeted proteomics, if we would like to test for multiple conditions, this would be a serious problem. Okay. And this is the kind of matrices that you would have in this type of screening proteomics, where you would have a lot of identifications that you can actually afterwards use for quantification of this protein in different time points, for instance. But here you would also have a lot of missing values. And these are technical missing values. So it's not that the protein is not there, but it's a problem of technology that we are not reproducible enough. And this is because of the stochastic sampling effect of this approach. Therefore, this delivers large number of missing values, therefore low reproducibility, non-consistent data sets, and therefore also low accuracy in quantitation, which are all very important concepts for quantitative proteomics. So, and here is when we can benefit from targeted proteomics. And I have classified the different workflows of targeted proteomics in four different modes. And this is the MS1 versus MS2 target methods. So things that we target at the MS1 level and things that we target at the MS2 level. So these are methods that rely on the mass of the entire peptide or the entire molecule, or methods that rely on the fragments of this molecule. And in a similar way, I also have divided this in what I call targeted acquisition, so things that, or acquisition or methods where we only acquire the protein data for the proteins that we are interested in, and targeted data analysis. So this would be methods where we record everything, and it's afterwards that we analyze the data, querying this data set for only the proteins that we are interested in. So here we have data for all the proteins, but we only quantify those that we are interested in, whereas here we only record data for those proteins that we pre-selected before the experiment. Okay, and this is a matrix, right? So MS1, MS2, targeted acquisition, and target data analysis. And in the next minutes, what I would like to do is to start filling these gaps and reviewing these options. And we will start with the MS1 targeted data analysis. Okay, so MS1 targeted data analysis. And this is very similar to the Shotgun workflow that I showed before. So this is an MS1 and a set of MS2 that were triggered based on the intensities of this MS1. And this is repeated in several cycles. But now, if I put all the so I just skip this MS2, so they are there, but just now I put all the MS1 one next to the other, you can see that, for instance, this red peak is decreasing along the time, whereas, for instance, this yellow one is increasing and then decreasing, and that this blue one is increasing and also then decreasing, and finally, the peptide that is eluting the latest is the brown one, okay? So this could also be done like this. Right, so I can draw the same, but so joining these points from the green to the green and then zero. So I would say, so first in the first MS1, we were here, we are then here, and then it disappears. For the blue one, for example, this dark blue, so it's not here, okay? Then it appears, it shows up, and then it disappears, and so on and so forth. So also for the yellow, it appears, and then it disappears. So this is another way of seeing this MS1 data, so as extracted chromatograms. And then I can also, so this is quite crowded, but I can also separate these extracted chromatograms based on mass charge. So each of these corresponds to a different mass. So here we only have one dimension, but then if I separate them in a second dimension, which would be the mass, I would have this kind of map. And now I just flip it over, so I would have this representation. This is exactly the same, but seen from above. Okay, so this is the time I separated each of them, and this is the mass charge. Exactly this, but flip. So then, if I have several runs, what I will have with the discovery proteomics approach is that, for example, in the first sample, I will have several signals. For some of them, which are the ones with a color here, I would have an identification, so a proper MS2 that provided me with MS sequence information. And in this case, there are these three. In the second sample, the features for which we have identification information are others. Some overlap, some don't, and we know this because we just saw that this shotgun approach has this problem of reproducibility in triggering MS2 data. But actually, we are smart enough, so if we would analyze this data manually, I could say, well, actually, I can link this by comparing this. I mean, I don't need MS2 information to know that this is the green one. Okay, I can share mass, charge, and time information across runs, and therefore fill these gaps that were missing. Okay, so I can simply by comparing the features or the pattern of features, I can share, and sharing this, I can recover a lot of information, and I can use this MS1 for quantitation, right? So, and then we would actually, by doing this alignment and share of information, I can color all the features that are in these maps, okay? And this is what I would call the MS1 targeted data analysis. So we have the data, it's there at the MS1 level. We use the identifications and the information about mass, charge, and time to share this information across runs. And then we use the MS1 signals to quantify consistently these proteins in multiple conditions and multiple replicates. Advantages and disadvantages of this method. So this method has the advantage that actually virtually we could quantify everything. So all the proteins that are in my sample are there, right? So I have recorded everything at the MS1 level. So I have not recorded everything at the MS2 level, but I have all information at the MS1 level, right? So any protein that, so I have an hypothesis, I can go there and by knowing information such as mass, charge, and time, I can go there and share this information, sequence information among runs and get the quantitation. The problem is that there is a limited dynamic range, right? Because as we are acquiring the whole range of masses, the likelihood that abundant features appears or co-appear with low abundant features is quite high. And therefore, given that the mass spectrometer only has about 3 orders of magnitudes, so if the difference between two signals is more than 3 orders of magnitudes, I will not be able to record this. So it will not be in the MS1 information. And also, there is a lot of chemical noise. What does this mean? There are so many things that are eluting at the MS1 level that many signals overlap, and then for quantitation purposes, it's difficult to check whether there is, interferences or the signal that you are trying to quantify comes from the protein or the peptide you actually want to quantify or from other species that are co-eluting. Okay, so. So I see that some put jackets, so I will do the thermostat. Okay, so this is MS1 target data analysis. We acquire everything at the MS1 level. We query the data for particular information of selected proteins. But then, so if we have all these limitations, some of you could ask, well, if I'm only interested in 5 proteins, why I have to record everything in the MS1 level? Why I don't just focus on a particular mass range of my peptide and I only do this, right? And this is what is called the selected ion monitoring. Or we could also tell it selected peptide monitoring, right? But the official name is selected ion monitoring. And here what we do is instead of using the mass analyzer as a screening mode at the MS1 level, we filter this and only filter this for the mass of my peptide of interest. So let's say 500. So I set this and then I record it over time, all the time, and then I have a record of the intensity of this particular mass. Okay, so I only acquire data for this peptide of interest. And then it doesn't matter whether it's eluting or not. So here it would be not non-eluting, but I record signal for this, and then it goes up to intensity and then down again and then another and another. And then as you can see here, as there are many peptides that actually are isobaric, we can have different signals, and we would have to know which is the correct one. And we can actually deduce this by what is called seem triggered MS2. So we can set a threshold and say, well, whenever this threshold or the signal goes above this threshold, then trigger an MS2. So now with this strategy, I would be filtering for my particular peptide, and I can have particular MS2 information that gives me which is the sequence of the peptide that is eluting at this retention time and which is the peptide that is eluting in this second retention time. And the other thing is that, so here we are recording everything, or so we are recording the peptide all the time. But actually it's not necessary that we record it all the time. Maybe we can record it every second. Okay, so this is not every millisecond, but every second. And then what happens is this, right? So we have a point every second, and actually with this data, it's fairly easy to draw a line and have the same, exactly the same profile. Okay, but this provides us with something which is very interesting, which is a gap of time. Okay, so from the first second to the second second, I have nothing to do. And this, we can use this gap of time or gap of operation to monitor a second one. Okay, so I can use these gaps to monitor a second piece. And therefore, I can multiplex this. So it's not that I can only monitor one peptide, but I can monitor 2, 3, 4, or as many as I want, given the cycle time. Okay, tomorrow you will, so Christina will be doing a presentation on parameter optimization of SRM, and she will discuss much in detail this cycle time problem and how many peptides we can indeed multiplex in our assays. But it is important that we are not recording a signal all the time, but just in intervals, and therefore we have gap times that we can use for multiplexing. Okay, which are the advantages and limitations of this second targeted workflow? Okay, so the advantages is that as we are not recording everything, but just the mass range of interest, so we have an improved dynamic range, and we can also multiplex for many different peptides. But the main limitation is that we have only quantitative information for those peptides that we were monitoring, because this is indeed an MS1 targeted data acquisition. So we are only acquiring data for the peptides that we have selected previously to the experiment. Okay, so if at the end of the experiment you would say, now that I saw the quantity of these 3 or 4 proteins, it would be interesting to have another protein measure. So then you have to repeat the measurement because you only have data for the ones that you selected previously. And limitations is still that there are, even though we filter and we only record masses for a particular M over Z, so there is still a lot of things that might fit in this particular mass, so many isobaric peptides, and therefore still a lot of chemical noise. So to improve especially this chemical noise problem, so there was what is called the MS or selected reaction monitoring that I called here the MS2 targeted data acquisition, and this has been again called selected reaction monitoring. Maybe it would be easy to understand if we would say selected fragment monitoring, right? So because what we do is we monitor fragments of the peptides. Okay, so in this case, which is, you will see that the setup is very similar to the SIM that we just saw, but with a extra filtering step. So here we filter first for the mass of our peptide of interest, we fragment, and then we filter again for one specific fragment of this peptide. Of course, this double filtering produces a lot of the chemical noise because the likelihood that two peptides that weigh the same have also two fragments that weigh the same is much lower than if we would only be doing one filtering the step. Okay? And then the type of data that we have is exactly the same. So we are doing this filtering no matter whether the peptide is eluting or not, and therefore we have zero intensity when it's not eluting, then we have peaks, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is exactly what I said before, so that we have less chemical noise, and therefore we can have better sensitivity, right? So here I put zepto, atom, and femtomoles. Let's say for non-selected peptides, meaning that we choose a random peptide from the proteome, I would say that the fair sensitivity would be, or the first say thing to say is that we are at the femtomole level of sensitivity with this technique. If we start selecting peptides, or we are lucky and we select a peptide that is in, has a very nice response, so concentration, the relationship between concentration and intensity is very good, then we could go to atomoles, and there are even some publications that claim that they go to high septomole level. Okay, so again, here in SRM, we can also do SRM-triggered MS2, same way that we did it in selected ion monitoring. So we filter here, we filter for the specific fragment, and when the signal is above a certain threshold, we triggered an MS2, and therefore, although I was only monitoring one fragment, now I have information for all the fragments, and I can actually be more sure about the fact that this is my peptide or not. Okay, so here I was monitoring one fragment, now I have information of all the fragments, I can use this in a search engine to identify which peptide is eluting at that moment. Oops. Okay, good. And in the same way as before, we can also multiplex, because we scan it not every all the time, but only in intervals of 1 or 2 seconds, and therefore we can put, for instance, we can select exactly the same peptide, but monitor a second fragment. So here we are filtering for the same peptide of interest. Here I monitor fragment 1, here fragment 2. You can see that both are co-eluting, but I can also introduce, I can also multiplex other peptides. So here I would be filtering the second peptide of interest with one of its fragments, the same second peptide with another fragment of interest. Okay, this is how actually traces of SRM transitions look like in real world. So these are the different fragments being monitored. So for example, a B4, Y6, Y7, they are all co-eluting, because actually the peptide is eluting from the column at this precise retention time. And then we can actually use this ranking with, for example, so we have this information of different transitions. We know which is the rank of each transition. We might have a reference MS spectrum, either from triggered MS2 data or from synthetic peptides that we have measured before, or from a spectral library that it's publicly available. So what we know is that this peptide has not only these fragments, but actually each of these fragments has a particular intensity. And we can correlate this distribution of intensities with our reference MS2, and then be more sure about the identification of the signal. And this has been, for example, this comparison has been implemented in informatic tools such as mProfit, that takes into account this ranking and coelution, plus many other features that we will be reviewing on Thursday, right? To assign a probability that this set of transition corresponds to the peptide that you are trying to monitor. Okay, not only this, but also, as I said, we can multiplex, and this is just one run in which we are targeting 96 different peptides. Okay, one run, so I'm doing the analogy that Rudy was doing in the keynote, so this would be the equivalent of doing 96 Western blots in one run. Okay, so here we are monitoring 96 peptides. For each of them, we have an intensity, and then if we do this in several different conditions or samples, we can actually compare and do relative quantification. So the advantages and limitations of SRM. So we have both things. So now we have identification and quantification with the same signal. So here, right, I have not only area under the peak that I can use for to quantify this peptide, but actually I also have a list of transitions that I can use, list of transitions and rankings of intensity that I can use for identification. Okay. Then we have an improved dynamic range, because we are doing a double filtering. also an improved signal to noise, also because of this double filtering, high sensitivity, and the possibility to do multiplexing. Okay, but the limitations again would be that we don't have data for all the proteins in the proteome, but for a specific set of proteins that you have selected before the experiment. So, and this is why is MS2 targeted data acquisition method. Okay. Then there is another type of MS2 targeted data acquisition workflow, which is called parallel reaction monitoring. And if we remember, in SRM, we did what we call, or I call, sequential acquisition, right? So this means that we first monitor the first peptide, then one fragment, and then after this has been accomplished, we do the same for the second fragment, and then we go for the second peptide, so on and so forth. So one after the other. But actually, it would be interesting to be able to multiplex this and filter one peptide and have the information of all the fragments at the same time, right? Because in this way, we would gain cycle time and we could even multiplex more peptides. And this is what parallel reaction monitoring does. So it does parallel acquisition of the MS2 information or the fragment information. And how it does this, so instead of using two filters, so for what we normally use, two quadruples, it uses a screening or a filtering mass analyzer here as a first mass analyzer, and then the second mass analyzer in a screening mode, normally like a TOF or an Orbitrap. Okay? And therefore, now you can actually filter for your peptide of interest, fragment this peptide, and acquire all the data of at the same time of your MS2 fragments. And now, by repeating this several times, you can actually, right, so now what you would have is, if we put all the MS2 together of the PRM, so we can, again, as we were doing in the same way we were doing for MS1, we can actually draw a line from this red one to this red one to this red one, and then we can have elution profiles, okay? And also similarly to what we did in SRM, if I just overlap these elution profiles, we have this type of data, which is in is very similar to SRM data. Okay, the only difference, so the treatment of the data for example quantitative analysis would be the same as SRM, but the how we acquire this data is slightly different. Okay, the advantages are very similar to those that I explained by SRM. So we have identification and quantification at the same time. We have improved dynamic range, good signal to noise ratio. And here it's not because, so in SRM we had a good signal noise to ratio because we were doing a double filtering. Okay? Here we only do one filtering, then this should reduce the signal to noise and increase the chemical noise. But actually what this technique benefits from is the high resolution of the TOF instruments and the Orbitrap instruments. So this high resolution of these mass analyzers compared to the quadrupole makes that we still can have a good signal-to-noise ratio even though we only do one filtering step. Okay? And the limitations are that we can only have quantitative information from the proteins of interest. Good. So before going on the methods, I would like to dedicate some time on how we do an experimental setup for this type of experiments. But before going into this, I would like to know whether there are any questions. Yeah? Everything clear? Okay. I mean, it's important. Also, there are a lot of terminologies and a lot of ways to name the same technique or similar techniques, and it's important that at this point of the course, right, so all this terminology is clear. So if there is something that is not well understood or you need to repeat, so let's say this session would be the moment to do it. Okay, so then we go for the experimental setup for SRM and PRM, and the first step, of course, is to select the proteins of interest, right? So you would have signaling pathway, whatever your hypothesis, you select the proteins that you want to monitor. And once you have these proteins, then you would go to peptide selections, right? These proteins can come from your own experiments, from the literature, wherever you want, right? And then the next question is, well, now that I have my favorite proteins that I want to measure, which peptide should I monitor, okay? And then we should use what we call prototypic peptides, so peptides that are unique, that they are triptic, so especially if you are digesting with trypsin, right? So if you are digesting with trypsin, you would like to avoid or... so, well, depending on the... Well, let's say unique, that they are triptic, RK, they might contain miscleavage, right? So traditionally it has been said that that miscleavages are not advisable, but actually there are some miscleavages that are very consistent and robust. So you digest the same sample and the variability that you have in the amount of miscleavage is very similar. So you can also use, in those cases, these miscleavage peptides for quantitation. In cases, for example, for miscleavages that depends on phosphorylation or other modifications, then it's more tricky because actually the degree of phosphorylation of your peptide of interest might actually distort the miscleavage ratio, okay? And then peptides that are between a length of 6 to 25 residues, and then also, if possible, you would like to avoid amino acids that might have these ends, right? So KK or RR, because these are normally miscleavages due to the digestion that are not so reproducible as others. And then amino acids that might undergo through secondary reactions such as oxidation or deamidation, and if you know them, so avoid amino peptides that have post-translational modifications. Of course, you will see, and for those of you that have already done SRM experiments, you know that if you apply all these rules, no peptides are left. Okay, so then it's kind of compromise, right? And also, for instance, you can actually monitor oxidized and not oxidized form of the same peptide, miscleavage, not miscleavage form, so on, right? And this is, I mean, each of you will know better the system and the type of peptides and proteins that you are working with, whether they are being modified by biological conditions or not, and therefore you have, at least you have to be aware, and then select your peptides accordingly, okay? And then, so you would also like to select peptides that have high response of MS, right? So given a protein, you want to select those peptides that at least other people have seen in mass spectrometry, because if no one has seen this peptide before, it's quite unlikely that you will be the first person to see this peptide with the same technique, okay? And therefore, you can use either experimental in-house data. So normally, many people, before doing a targeted assay, have already shotgun data from the same sample, so you can see which were the peptides that were more visible or more intense for a particular protein. But you can also go to public repository data and query these databases for your particular protein and see which peptides have been seen by other laboratories. Okay. Then once we have selected the protein and the peptide, the next step is, well, as in SRM we are monitoring fragments, I would like to know which fragment I want to monitor, right? And then, of course, you would like to monitor the most intense fragments, because these fragments are the ones that will provide the best sensitivity. And to select which are the best fragments, one strategy would be, for example, to buy synthetic peptides, which are commercially available. They are quite cheap. And then you can do MS2 experiments on this, have nice MS2 spectra, and then you can rank. Okay, so here we rank each of the fragments, and we select, let's say, the top 3, the top 4, or the top 5, or what, as many fragments as you want, depending also on the cycle time and the number of targets that you are monitoring. Okay, so this would be an example of a real MS2 for this particular peptide from in-house shotgun MS data. And then we would select, for instance, so if we're monitoring three different fragments, so we would monitor these three. Okay? It's important also that to keep in mind that the transitions or the fragments that you are monitoring are used for two things. One is quantitation, right? So area under the curve, but the other one is also the identification of your peptide, right? Because you rely on these fragments, especially if you in complex samples, to know that what you are targeting is, or what you are measuring is exactly what you want to measure, right? So, for instance, if this is Y7 plus, and this is Y7 plus 2, and this would be Y7 plus 3, okay, so same fragment, different charge states, this would be good for quantitation, but actually would provide almost no information for peptide identification. Okay, so there is also a compromise on this, especially if you are monitoring very few transitions, three or four transitions, to also maximize the sequence information that you get from your assays. Okay, and then, so this fragmentation that I was showing here, we can actually do it in shotgun data, and so some people have done comparisons on how reproducible or how equal or unequal are these MS2 spectra from different vendors or from different collision energies, fragment chambers, and mass analyzers. Okay, so for example, this is so this is one peptide, this is second peptide, so these are two examples, and this is the quadrupole, so where we perform the MS2, the SRM experiments, this is also the MS2, and for here we have CID and HCD. Okay, there is a general consensus that HCD in orbit traps reflect better what you will have in your triple quadrupole. What is sure is that if you perform your MS2 spectra in the same instrument that you will perform afterwards your SRM assays, this will give you the best correlation between your MS2 relative intensities and your SRM relative intensities. Okay, but in general, they are quite, so let's say the top five fragments will be the top five fragments, maybe in different order, but the top five will be the same in orbit traps than in SRM. Okay, and the final, once we have this assay, the next step would be to do the peptide quantitation. And here I show an endogenous peptide from the sample and the same peptide monitored in the same sample in which we spike a reference peptide, right? So this is the signal from the endogenous. This is a signal for, so this is a signal from the endogenous. This is a signal from the reference peptide. And then for quantitation purposes, we would integrate the area and compare this with this, okay? But you will perform this later in the tutorials also, and how to do all this quantitation stuff. Okay, so we have reviewed MS1, targeted acquisition, MS2, targeted acquisition, and MS1, targeted data analysis. And now there is the last gap that we would like to fill, which is targeted data analysis, MS2. Okay, and so so here, right, so there was the ions, so, okay. Okay, so here we were filtering in selected ion monitoring. We were filtering on the MS1 level. Here we were filtering in selected reaction monitor in the MS1 and the MS2 level. And in parallel reaction monitor, we were filtering in the MS1 level and screening in the MS2 level, right? In all of them, we are filtering for a particular peptide, okay, our peptide of interest. And we are losing all the other information. And the thing is, would it be possible to monitor everything all the time? Okay, and this actually is something that someone tried. Okay, and this was what is called the precursor acquisition independent from ion count. So what they did is a kind of PRM. Okay, isolating, for example, from 400 to 2.5, well, to 400 to 2.5. Okay, so from 400 to 402.5, then from 402.5 to 102, and so on and so forth. Okay, so they were doing these small windows and fragmenting, no matter whether there is my peptide of interest or not, but along the whole mass range. Okay, and then, for instance, when you filter for in windows of 2.5 daltons, which is what a normal Orbitrap would do, right? You can scan all these windows in 3 seconds. You can see that in 3 seconds, which is a reasonable cycle time, they were able to map from 400 to 413. Okay, not much. But then they were injecting the same sample again and doing from 413 to 420, and so on and so forth. And what they read, right? So this is what they were doing. And as you can see, it took them 50 runs and 4 days. Okay, so your same sample would have been in, or you should, you would need to inject it for 50 times. Okay. Then there is the opposite. Okay, so people said, well, let's relax this filter, and instead of doing small isolations of 4 Daltons or of 2 Daltons, let's filter everything, or just we don't filter. We let everything go in, we fragment everything, and we have this complex MS2 spectra. And this is what is called MSE. Okay, so here we have fragments of everything that is eluting at this moment. So, and these are very, very complex spectra with lots of fragments that afterwards we need to deconvolute or demultiplex to know which fragments comes from which peptides. Okay? And then, so, but these two ideas are not new. So these were also this type of data acquisition, which is what I call also data-independent MS2 acquisition, because you acquire data at the MS2 level, independent of what is eluting from your column. So you try to record everything. And this was suggested by Yates in 2004, where they were doing this relaxed filtering with windows of 10 Daltons, right? So it was not so extreme as doing windows of 1 Dalton or 2 Daltons, neither windows of 1,000 Daltons, but actually 10 Daltons. And they were filtering a relaxed filter here and acquiring all the fragments at the MS2 level, right? Again, so they did this from 400 to 1,400, getting a cycle time of, well, I don't know now, but let's say of a few seconds, and with a lot of complex MS2 spectra. Okay, and what they realized is actually that some things that, these are one peptide here, a second peptide here, and what they realized is that, of course, as you are filtering, you get better signal to noise, and things that were not properly seen at the MS1 level were actually really nice at the MS2 level, and you could use this information to quantify. Okay, at that point they didn't know much how to analyze these complex spectra, right? But we know how to do it, right? Because we also saw it in MS1 workflows, right? And the thing is the coelution of the fragments, right? So again, now I colored the fragments, but in a real experiment, you would not know. But actually, if you compare the green ones here to here to here, so this is time, right? So you see that it was eluting here and then it disappears. The blue one, it started eluting here, then it goes up, up, and up. And others, like the, for example, the red ones, so they start eluting, go up, down, and they disappear. Okay, so and by this concept of coelution, there were several softwares that appeared, like XDIA from Yates, also the convolution of mixture spectral from Makos, and then recently also from Rudy Everson lab. So they did the same they applied the same concept, but also integrating additional information such as peptide libraries to know the ranking of the intensities and retention time information that improves quite a lot the assignment of the identifications of the peptides that are polluting, and then you have quantitation and trustable identification. Okay? And what you have here is, so if you remember parallel reaction monitoring, we had MS2s, right, that we were linking together. So this is exactly the same, but with more complex MS2 data, right? So we have MS2, we link them together, and then we trace this, and we will have with this MS2 target data analysis, so we will have the same type of traces that we can use for quantitation. Okay, there are several workflows or ways to do this, like MSX. Maybe you heard about it. SWOT. It's also another way to do this. But all of them have the same concept of doing relaxed filtering modes, so windows of 10, 20, 25, whatever, in the MS1 level, and then record the MS2 level in a regular mode. Okay, so that at the end you can link by coelution these features and identify peptides based on retention time and peptide libraries. So this provides, these are real data from Gillette's paper from Rudy Everson's lab of how this type of data looks like. You can see that they are actually very similar to what we saw in SRM data, and actually it improves also quite a lot. So this is the sensitivity, the dynamic range, and this type of techniques actually improve sensitivity. Okay, so main advantages and disadvantages, it's that it can identify and quantify the signals that you have. It has improved dynamic range, improved signal to noise, high sensitivity. You can multiplex, actually you can virtually quantify everything, similar to what we were doing at the beginning of the talk with MS1. So you have the whole map, you can quantify everything. So now we have an MS2 map, we can actually query it for any peptide or protein that you want. And the limitations, I would point the data complexity and data size also, and the difficulty of querying this data. So, and this is something that we would like to address in this course, especially on Thursday and Friday, to show you how to actually get the most information out of this data. Okay? And with this, right, so I finish here. This is what we saw today. So targeted proteomics workflows at the MS1 level, at the MS2 level with targeted acquisition, only acquiring data for peptides of interest. Targeted data analysis, we acquire everything either at the MS1 level or at the MS2 level, and it's afterwards that we query these data sets for the particular proteins of interest. Okay? Good. So we finish here.